Hi, I'm Rick Emerson, and welcome back to Outlook Portland on Northwest 32 TV. We're here with Miss Anina Bennett and Mr. Paul Guinan, and they are the creative force behind such works as Heartbreakers and Boilerplate. Boilerplate is this sort of, I keep thinking of it as kind of like a mechanical Mrs. Butterworth that's just sort of sitting in the middle of the table during breakfast.
That's right, syrup actually comes out of the rifle.
What I said in the beginning that it was, I referred to it as a graphic novel, which I know in my heart is wrong. That's probably inaccurate. What is Boilerplate?
You're not the first person to call it that. In fact, there was an article in the Hollywood Reporter last summer that mistakenly called it a hybrid graphic novel picture book. And that got repeated all over the place. Basically, everybody who quoted it just cut and pasted out of it without actually thinking about what they were doing. But Boilerplate is a different kind of visual narrative. It's words and pictures, but it's photographs and columns of text, basically. But we took all of our comic book experience doing visual narratives and applied it to working with the designers to do a different kind of visual narrative for Boilerplate.
It's most closely resembles a pop history book, a coffee table pop history, where you have columns of text and these images that accompany it. I have joked in the past that it's kind of like a graphic novel without word balloons or panel borders, but that just further confuses people.
Yeah, because everything really goes in a very specific sequence, and certain images need to go with certain parts of the text, and so it was a very challenging design job. I don't envy the guys who had to work with us.
There is a narrative through line. The inventor of the robot has a character arc, and really it was an excuse to connect the dots in history. Quite often in these kinds of pop history books, you'll have these disparate events, famous people, and including a fictional character like this and having him act as sort of an MC allowed us to sort of take you by the hand and guide you through these different events and people in this historical period.
And so it is the story to, in a boiled down sense, no pun intended, it is the story of Boilerplate as a character in or participant in or observer of historic events throughout history, from when to when? What time span does it cover?
Well, it's at the turn of the 19th, 20th century, essentially. So the robot is invented by this guy named Archibald Campion, who has a relative who dies in battle between the Civil War and the 1890s. And he introduces the robot to the public at the World's Fair in Chicago in 1893.
His intent is that no one else should die needlessly in combat. And it's a very idealistic notion, considering that this is before World War I. When the military mind still considered war to be an honorable pursuit. So the idea of replacing the stalwart infantryman with a robot is considered to be dishonorable. And so they never actually purchase him. He never goes into production. But the inventor continues to try and demonstrate him and show his capabilities.
Right. So he thinks if he can replace human soldiers with this robot, with this, you know, mechanical man, that then men won't have to die in the battlefield. So he takes the robot all over the world to demonstrate it, and that's how they get involved in all these famous historical events, and ultimately in World War I, where the robot goes missing in action. But the robot really participates in history without altering it, essentially.
Was there a moment where the whole idea, the concept, crystallized for you, or was it in a flash, or was it gradual?
Well, Paul gets all the credit for coming up with the blindingly simple yet brilliant idea.
it did come out of
it's history with a robot in it.
It did come out of a visual image of that I had of a robot with Teddy Roosevelt at San Juan Hill. I just, for some reason, I thought that was particularly amusing and interesting image. And really, I wanted to tell straightforward historical adventure stories from a period of time that I think is particularly important. I mean, this the end of the 19th century is essentially the origin of our modern world, not just in technological terms like the airplane and the telephone, the motor car, but also in day-to-day social stuff you wouldn't necessarily think for take for granted, such as
culture, geopolitics,
women having the right to vote, children not having to work in factories, things like this.
So but you were originally thinking of Boilerplate as a graphic novel, and it was kind of hard to sell just sort of straightforward historical fiction at that time, right? Because there weren't a lot of book publishers doing graphic novels yet.
So I took a cue from things that had existed before, like, for instance, Gore Vidal has written a series of novels about American history in which he takes a fictional protagonist and puts him in authentically researched settings. Or a more pop culture example of that would be the Young Indiana Jones television series, in which Indiana Jones participates in history without interfering or changing it. So everything is, the outcome is all the same, and you accidentally learn some stuff about history.
One of our favorite fan letters actually was from one of the producers or one of the writers of Young Indy.
Oh, I forget.
Well, he emailed us through our website and just told us how much he loved the book. And we were like, oh, that's awesome, because
that's
your show is actually one of the inspirations.
It started out as a series of, well, it is a series of photographs that are bound, but it started out as an online-only project.
Right. I'd built this figurine here, in fact, and photoshopped it into a series of vintage images, put it up on our website, and people believed it to be real. I set up the website to suggest that this was a real creature from 100 years ago.
When you say they believed it to be real, they believed it to be real, or they believed it to be a real attempt at a hoax?
Well, here's the thing.
Both. Different people.
Yeah. U.S. News and World Report did a cover article about hoaxes in which this was used as an example of an inadvertent hoax. I mean, I wasn't deliberately trying to deceive. I was just having fun with Photoshop. And I certainly expected a small percentage of people to buy it. But it was when history students or robotics students started writing me, asking me for more information about this, that I realized,
Then there was a handful of people who thought it was a hoax, but from the 19th century, like the Piltdown Man or something.
We're talking with Mr. Paul Guinan and Ms. Anina Bennett. You are watching Outlet Portland right here on Northwest 32 TV. We will continue right after this. Don't go anywhere.